This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm Doyle Davidson, servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas and Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to declare unto you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4 tell us what the gospel is, how that Jesus Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. He was buried. He rose again the third day according to the scripture. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind. Thank God. The word is nigh thee, even in your heart and in your mouth. Is a word of faith which I preach. You will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. You shall be saved. With the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Thank God. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed. Therein, what? The gospel. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by his faith. We have an opening song ministered by Terre Brown, one of my very favorite songs. One day at a time, and I'll be back, Terry.
I'm only human. I'm just a woman. Help me believe in what I can be and all that I am. Show me the stairway I have to climb. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day. That's all I'm asking from you. Give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Help me today. Show me the way one day at a time. Do you remember when you walked among men? Jesus, you know when you're looking below, it's worse now than then. Cheating and stealing. One day at a time. One day at a time. Sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking from you. Give me the strength to do every day. one day at a time.
January 2nd, I walked away from my idol. Thank God, 121 Veterinary Hospital, McKinney, Texas. I built it myself, designed it. I didn't do all the work, but I was a contractor. And I had a lot of fun with it, about 2.5 years. And God said, sell it, get out of it. I knew, and I had to obey God. You can read about on my website about the whole thing. But I'm not here to talk about that. I'm here to talk about God leading me, taking over my life, leading me according to the Word of God, leading me, Jesus, my example. And he led me just exactly like he led Jesus. Thank God. 1970 to 71 in Missouri. 71 to 72 in Opa-locka, Florida, managing a small animal hospital. May 72, back to Texas, Argyle. Amazing place to be. Amazing. I arrived back expecting everything to be improved. Everything went downhill, according to the flesh, not according to God. I had substantial cash, but I couldn't spend it. Couldn't find property. I actually agreed to buy 2 pieces of property. The next day, they turned me down. It wasn't easy. And I wasn't a man, and I'm not a man easily discouraged. I was determined to do what I thought God had told me to do. He put me and Pat, who's in heaven, in the Holiday Inn, pardon me, in Denton, Texas, for 10 weeks. 10 weeks. Couldn't find a piece of property to buy or lease. Amazing, the temptations that I had. But I trusted I was following God. I had no one that believed I was obeying God. They thought I was on some ego trip. I wasn't stupid enough to call that an ego trip. I told God one day, one thing for sure, this must be you. There's no man smart enough to put me in this place. Didn't bother God a bit. 10 weeks looking for property of a morning, of each morning, and studying the book of Romans in the afternoon. I finally reduced my study to Romans, to the first 5 chapters. I could see there were the 5 that I most needed at that time. And where did that wisdom come from? The Lord, of course. After 10 weeks, I bought 6.5 acres with a house, a couple of small sheds on it made from sheet metal. And I expected things to improve financially. It went down, 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 down. I never got very discouraged. I wouldn't allow myself to be discouraged. Disappointment, yes. But I believe God was leading me according to the steps that Jesus took when he came out of the River Jordan. Kathie D is going to read the book of Luke, chapter 4, some verses. You ready?
Ready. Luke 4, 1 and 2. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And in those days he did eat nothing, and when they were ended, he afterward hungered.
Amen. Preacher after preacher came. What are you doing here? Obeying God. What's that? It was funny. One came out one day and he said, Dr. Davidson, what are you doing in Texas? I said, obeying God. And how's that? So I told him. Then I told him I'd received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, spoke in tongues. He was a Baptist and he ran. Ran to his van. I followed him all the way. I said, do you want to speak in tongues? No. I had to have something to entertain me. About 6 weeks later, a motorcycle rode in to the house. Got out, I went out to meet him. I mean, he got off. I went out to meet him. He said, may I talk to you? I said, sure. What do you want? He said, do you know anything about the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Sure. He said, could you help me get baptized in the Holy Ghost? I said, oh, sure. Prayed for him. He rode off on his motorcycle speaking in tongues. Guess who he was? The youth director of that Baptist church. Oh, was I happy. Messed up another Baptist. You see, my mother was a Baptist. I had to have something to laugh about. But it got worse. It got bad. 4 years. 4 years. No fun. Patty was doing, that's my wife, in heaven now. She did the best she could, but she wasn't ready for what we went through. Not at all. I ended up borrowing $36,000 from a bank in that 4 year period without any security. The president of the bank was a friend. He said, when are you going to straighten your life up? I've known you a long time, and I've never seen you act like this. Well, he hadn't known me that long. I just turned 40 when I moved there in May of 72. 40 in April. But my Lord, I was about to learn things about temptations, about the dealings of God in a man's life that you wouldn't believe. The church do not want to believe it. They think I'm some radical fool. Well, I'm a fool, but not radical. I'm a fool for Christ's sake. I learned that from the Bible. The Apostle Paul said he was a fool for Christ's sake. Those days were scary. But I want Kathie D. to read Luke, please, where he went to the wilderness. Luke 4.
Luke 4, starting in verse 1 again. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan, was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And in those days he did eat nothing, and when they were ended, he afterward hungered. And the devil said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. And Jesus answered him, saying, It is written, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil taketh him up into a high mountain, showed him unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me. And to whomsoever I will, I give it. If thou wilt worship me, all shall be thine. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. And he brought him to Jerusalem, and set him on a pinnacle of the temple, and said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from thence, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. And Jesus answering said unto him, It is said, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season.
For a season. Notice Jesus was tempted 40 days, not just three times. I was tempted day and night. Unreal. Things that people would say to me, things that people did to me, especially theologians. They just thought I was on a trip. I wouldn't listen to them. God had told me not to. Thank God. But I learned something quickly. I learned it from Jesus. When he talked to the devil, man shall not live by bread alone. Get this, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. I said, oh, so this is the way you live. Right. James chapter 1, verse 22. I've already been taught, be a doer of the word, not a hearer only, deceiving your own self. A doer of the word, not a hearer only, deceiving your own self. Jesus lived in the word. He was the word. He is the word. But he lived by that word. It's the doctrine of the Father, John 7. 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation taken you such as common to man. None, the Lord had told me, would ever be put in front of me, common to man. And with every temptation, He would bind a way that I could escape and bear it. I said to him once, I can't bear any more of this. Shut up. He said, You don't know how much you can bear. And I shut up, but I thought, I don't want to find out either. But Job didn't sin with his lips. And I made every effort to not sin with mine. I had some fear of God for certain. And I obeyed. And I got out of that place. But let's look at this second temptation. Would you read it?
Second temptation.
Big one.
And he took him up into a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time.
Hold it. You know Satan can give you visions? He gave Jesus a vision. Oh, you people, Is that your visions? Are they of God or are they of the devil? Satan can deceive you. He couldn't deceive Jesus. Would you go on?
Right. Took him up into a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will, I give it. If thou will therefore worship me, all shall be thine.
Did you notice all you have to do to be exalted is worship the devil to be exalted by him? You notice that? Yeah. And Jesus wouldn't do that. But Satan wanted Jesus to worship him. That's his operation. And Jesus, what did he say? To worship him is tempting him. Is that right? Would you read that again?
Yes, he said, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve.
Right. Worship the Lord thy God. Did you know Satan wants you to worship him? Did you know the world's full of people that worship the devil? In the name of Jesus, in the name of Christ, when you end your prayer in Christ's name, what Christ is it? I've heard it a long time. In Christ's name, is that Antichrist or is that Jesus Christ? Some can't even say Jesus Christ because they're the wrong spirit. Beloved, believe not every spirit, 1 John 4, verse 1, for there are many false prophets gone out into the world. But try the spirit, whether they be of God or not. Oh, my friends, know this. I've been tempted many, many times in 46 years. By the mercy and grace of God, I've never fallen into a great temptation. Oh, I've been on the edge, real close. I thought a few times I had fallen in. No, it was that thing that Peter said, think it not strange, the fiery trial that is to try you. And I thought a few times, surely this is a big temptation. No, it was a strange trying of my heart and my faith. I stood my ground. I stood and held fast. And the Lord led me out of every one of them. The 4 years in Argyle, tough years, scary years. And then I got out. And then I went to Carrollton. But let's get the third big temptation.
Verse 9, and he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from thence. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. And Jesus answering said unto him, it is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God.
Amen. You know what Satan was saying to Jesus? Jump off and commit suicide. Did you know any time that you hear about suicide, it's not God. It's Satan himself or one of his lieutenants. Don't do it. You can stand if you'll believe. Trust God. He'll save you. He'll bring you through it. Don't be afraid. I was tempted with suicide 1 year. So was Patty in Carrollton. Unbelievable. Both of us just wept a bunch. I didn't know what had happened to me. Both of us fairly strong. And I was wise enough to say, don't talk more than you have to. Don't talk more than you have to. Leave strangers alone. Well, did I meet some nuts? Oh, yeah. After we got out of Carrollton in 76, both of us decided to talk. Both of us said, Satan was telling us, each of us, take your own life. Take your own life. You don't have any good thing ahead of you. You've been deceived. Did you know the devil will tell you you've been deceived by the devil? You know he's a liar? Nothing but a liar. But you know what? After we left in 77, we left the wilderness and we returned, verse 14, I think, that the power...
That is correct. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit unto Galilee. And there went out a fame of him throughout all the region round about. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified of all.
My friends, you can fast 100 years if you live that long. For a ministry, I've heard them say they fasted and prayed. They wanted a ministry. I didn't want one. I didn't want a ministry at all. I didn't fast and pray for a ministry. I fasted and prayed for some money. And I didn't want to pass a plate. That wasn't my style. I wanted to work and get my money. Finally, in 77, the month of June, God started turning my life around. What time?
We have 30 minutes.
Have 30?
Yeah.
Good. Started turning my life around. When he told me, give $100 to the First United Methodist Church, McKinney, Texas. And I had a discussion with the Lord. He said, obey me. I said, I repeated my dialogue with Jesus. Obey me. The third time, he said, obey me. I thought maybe I should. I'd been someplace I didn't want to go back. I'd read the Bible, the people with Moses. When they get upset, they murmur. When they murmured, the Lord would say, Moses, take them around the mountain again. I even bought a silly song. Take another lap around the mountain. And I was listening to that thing one day. I don't want to put your singer songwriting down, but that's a terrible song. Take another lap around the mountain. That's all I was doing. One day I took that, it was a, whatever it was, I took that record and I sailed right out through the timber. No, I don't want to hear those kind of songs. I listened to a church sing where I attended, a Baptist group. Lord, teach me to pray down on my knees until in your own good time you will answer me. I said, don't teach me that. I don't want to stay on my knees forever. Amen. That's a dumb prayer. When I told the preacher that, I made a great friend. You see, I was sent as a prophet, and I would sometimes speak the words of a prophet. But in 77, thank God, $100 First United Methodist Church, I made $1,026 that week. I thought, my goodness, I've not made $1,000 in a week in six years. So I gave another 100. I made another 1,000. I gave another 100. I made another 1,000. 3 weeks, it looks like I've got this thing working. Oh, it did. Maybe I've got the formula. Ha. And that fourth week, I gave 100 and did 400 and something. Oh, disappointment. God said, challenge the devil. Tell him, turn your money loose. I said, challenge the devil? I don't know if that's safe. But I thought, I'd just soon die, but I didn't want to, as go through another few years like Argyle and Carrollton. So I did. And I said, turn my money loose. Turn my money loose, devil. And he had to, because God told me to say it. It was his word, and I had faith. Money started coming. Thank God. Went from 1,000 to 1,500 a week, to 2,000, to 3,000. Oh, I thought, this is fun. God says, your practice is coming to an end. You're not trusting in the flesh anymore. You're going to trust me. You're going to live by faith. You're going to believe God when you don't know where it's coming from, when you can't look at them and tell them. I never told any church ever that I needed money, not once. I took up one offering in this building once, 82, maybe it was 83. It's called God's Offering. I think it's in a book of maybe Numbers, I don't know. And God told me to do it. I did. I needed about 100,000 and I got 23. I thought, this is not working. But you know what? God brought me through it. Got the 100,000. You can read about that. He never stopped telling me to give money. It went to up to 50% of the ministry money. Then 50 of my own money. And I've been doing that since 1986. I actually think I've said all that I want to say. I think Kathie D. is going to take this service, and she's going to finish it. And I'm going to have a seat here and smile. Kathie Davidson.
Amen. I'm going to begin by telling you about a man named John Newton. John Newton was 23 years old. This was back in the 1700s. He was in the North Atlantic on a ship, and the ship was in dire peril. In fact, the ship looked like it was going to be lost. John Newton, 23, his mother had died when he was the age of 6. His father was a merchant marine, so he joined his father when he was 11. He ended up being what he would call very insubordinate, very rebellious, and had a reputation for being the worst of the worst of sailors. And he's only 23. He was known to be the best at cursing around him. People knew him because he liked to make other people sin. He was so insubordinate and so rebellious that they forced him into the British Navy. And when he was in the Navy, he ran away. They got him. They flogged him. They demoted him. They put him on a slave ship. So he worked on a slave ship at the age before he's 23. He made a slave himself. They chained him to the ship. He almost died of starvation. He was given as a slave to a slave owner or a slave trader, and the trader treated him awfully, brutally. And the only reason that John survived was the captain recognized, the captain that knew his father recognized him and saved him. Now he's on this ship, the Greyhound, and it's in peril. It's filling up with water, and they had no chance of survival. John was standing at a place on the ship, and he moved over to get something, and the friend that was standing with him was washed overboard. John turned around and saw his friend go into the water. And in those days, you went into the water. They can't turn the ship around. You're dead. He's gone. John at one point told the captain he chained himself and another seaman to the ship pump to try to pump the water out of the ship. And he told the captain, he said, if this doesn't work, God have mercy on us. Well, John would tell you that when he said that, those words were heard in heaven. God have mercy on us. And John will tell you that that is where grace began to work. That's what he called it. He said at that moment, grace began to work. I want you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians, and we're going to look at that. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 9. This is the Apostle Paul speaking. And he said, for I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Verse 10, but by the grace of God, notice that, but, I persecuted the church of God, but. You know, I love that word, but. Sometimes that word can be one of the most comforting words you will ever read. But, by the grace of God, I am what I am. At this point, what was Paul? He was the apostle to the Gentiles. God sent him into Asia and Mesopotamia, and he got millions or hundreds and hundreds of people saved. He was an apostle. He could heal. He had the Spirit of God healed through him. He did all those works, all these miracles. That's what Paul was. And how did he say he got it? By the grace of God. What is grace? What is grace? Grace is undeserved favor. Grace is undeserved favor. You don't deserve it. You don't ask for it. Sometimes you don't even want it. But what is grace? It is undeserved favor. That's what John Newton was talking about. And Paul says here in verse 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And by his grace, by his undeserved favor, he said, which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. And look at this next phrase. Yet not I. I labored abundantly more than they all. I worked harder than the rest of them. He said, yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. Notice, grace works. Grace works. Grace works. And that story I told you, grace was working on John Newton. Grace worked on Paul. Why could Paul do the things and go the places that he did? Because of grace. Because of grace. Paul didn't deserve it. He told you he didn't deserve it. He said that he was least because he persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, the grace. By undeserved favor. Let's go to 1 Peter 1. Amen. I love this here. 1 Peter 1, I'm going to begin in verse 9. And this is Peter speaking. He says, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. And look at verse 10. Of which salvation? What salvation? The salvation of your souls. The prophets have inquired and searched diligently. Who prophesied of the grace. You see, they prophesied of the grace, the undeserved favor, the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in him did signify, that it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. Look at what grace does. Grace signifies, testifies of the sufferings of Christ and the grace should follow, the glory. What was that? That is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. What does grace always lead you to? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. You will find that grace will always lead you to Jesus. It'll always lead you. But let's go on. It says, manner of time, the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves. Do you see that? Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them, which have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desired to look into. Do you realize that they were prophesying of something that they didn't have? They did not have. The Old Testament, the Old Covenant, didn't have grace. It didn't have undeserved favor. It didn't have that with God. They had the law, and the law was you either do it or you die. They didn't have grace, but yet these prophets, searching diligently, they saw the grace was coming. They saw that there was going to be a people that God had favor on. God had favor on, and they searched diligently, and you know what? They knew it wasn't for them. It wasn't for them. It was for us. It was for us. Turn with me to John 1. Verse 17, for the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. The law came by Moses, but grace, favor with God, undeserved favor with God, came by Jesus Christ. That and truth. Where does grace always lead you? It always leads you to Jesus. It always leads you to death, burial, and resurrection. I want you to turn with me to Isaiah 53. We're going to look at the source, at the power of where grace is. I'm going to read to you verse 6. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And look at this next phrase. I want you to look at it. If you've got your Bible, turn there and look at this. This is a wonderful passage. It says, all we like sheep have gone astray. All of us have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And look at this. And the Lord, this is Jehovah, has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Who laid that iniquity on Jesus? Who laid that iniquity on Jesus? Who laid your iniquity on Jesus? The Father did. Amen. The Father did. Jehovah did. You want to know what undeserved favor is? Amen. Jesus is in the garden. He doesn't want to go to the cross because he knows what it's going to be like. He knows every bone of his is going to be put asunder. He knows that he is going to be beaten. He knows that he's going to be punched. He knows he's going to have a crown of thorns on his head. He knows that his heart's going to be melted in the midst of his bowels. He knows he's going to die a slow death. He doesn't want to go. He doesn't want to go. And he in the garden asked the Father, he said, my Father, all things are possible. Can you get me out of this? Do you see what Jesus is saying here? All things are possible. Can you remove this cup from me? Can you get me out of this? And you know what the Father's decision was? Jesus went on and he said, but not my will. Not my will, but your will. What's your will, Father? What is your will? Can you get me out of this? You as a parent, have you ever had a child come to you and say, can you get me out of this? I don't want to do it. And we as parents, when we see them suffering like that, what do we want to do? We want to get them out of it. But this is God, Jehovah, and this is Jesus saying, Father, what's your will? I'll do your will. What's your will? And you know what the Father's will was? Go to the cross. Go to the cross. I know you're hurting, but you're going to go to the cross. Why? Because there was a whole lot of other children God wanted to save. There was a whole lot of other children God wanted to save. You. He wanted to save you. His son at that point didn't want to go to the cross, but God said, you got to go. You got to go. Amen. You got to go because I've got children I want to save. Amen. And you know what the grace of God is? It says it right here. The Lord put the iniquity on Jesus. For instance, you're a murderer. God took that murder from you. And he put it on Jesus. That is grace. That is unmerited favor, undeserved favor from God. He took the murder from that murderer and he put it on Jesus. And Jesus died a murderer. Why? Because God loved you and he had grace. He had grace. Jesus brought the grace. Your iniquity, your perversities, your fear, whatever was wrong about you, whatever was wrong, fearfulness, trembling, rejection, murder, sexual perversion, drug dealing, hate, variance, all these things that are wrong in you, the Father took from you. And by the grace, the unmerited favor, what is wrong with you? What is that thing that bothers you? What is that thing about you that you don't like? You say I'm ugly. God took that from you. And he put it on Jesus. He put it on Jesus. He took it away from you and he put it on Jesus. You see what grace is? You didn't deserve it. You didn't even ask for it. Sometimes we don't even want it. But God took it from us and he put everything wrong with us on the body of Jesus. And Jesus hung up in front of the whole world, naked, bearing your sin, bearing your iniquity, bearing everything wrong about you, your poverty. Your fear, your doubt, your unbelief, your rebellion, your insubordination, all of that. John Newton's insubordination, he put it, took it from John, and he put it on Jesus. He put it on Jesus. And you know what Jesus did with it? He died with it. Jesus died the world's worst sinner. Do you realize that? The Father took your sin, put it on Jesus, and Jesus died the world's worst sinner. The world's worst. And where do you go when you're a sinner? You go to hell. And the Father sent Jesus to hell to pay for your sin. To pay for your sin. You want to talk about undeserved favor? You want to talk about grace? Have you ever considered, and I know some of us, we don't want to consider this, but have you ever considered Jesus burning in hell? Jesus talked about it. He said, I'm on my way to hell. He said, I'm going to go to the lowest parts of the earth. You ask any third grader what is in the middle of the earth, and they'll tell you, molten rock, heat, fire, fire. And that's where Jesus went. The Father sent him to the lowest parts of hell. Why? Because he was the world's worst sinner. He was paying for your and my sin. Jesus was paying for your and my sin. Have you ever considered somebody burning in hell? somebody burning in hell. That somebody was Jesus, and he was doing it for you. Amen. He was doing it for you. And the Father saw, watched him in hell, saw him burning in hell. The wrath of God was on Jesus. The wrath of God was on Jesus. The wrath that God should have had on us, should have put on us, he put on Jesus. He took it out on Jesus in hell. And you know what happened after that? The Father saw Jesus suffering in hell. Amen. Saw him suffering in hell. And at one point then he became satisfied. He was satisfied with what Jesus did for you and I. Satisfied. That's grace, folks. That's grace. That's undeserved favor. The Father saw what Jesus did for you and I was enough. And he raised Jesus from the dead. And when he raised Jesus from the dead, he forgave every sin that you have ever committed. He had forgiven. He has delivered you from your fear, from your doubt, from your unbelief. He did it when he raised Jesus from the dead. Now this John Newton, on that ship, he said after they pumped out as much water as they could, he went and he drove the ship. He went to the wheel. For 11 hours, he rowed. He drove that ship through the storm. 11 hours. He said grace was working. Grace was working. He was under the conviction, the grace of God. You know what grace comes from? It's the Holy Ghost. And that Holy Ghost, that Spirit of grace, was on that man for 11 hours, speaking to him, talking to him, persuading him, moving him. And he said at the end of 11 hours from being the worst of the worst sailor, at the end of 11 hours, he was born again. And not only did that grace bring that man to Jesus, but it kept the ship afloat, and they all survived. What kept the ship afloat? Grace. Grace working. You know that grace is working right now in here? Amen. That grace is working right now in here. You know what John did after he did that? He left the ship. He got married. He became a minister. And when he was a minister in a little town called Olay, England, he wrote a hymn. He wrote a hymn. And that hymn, you know, he wrote the hymn, Amazing Grace. John, after that trip, the 11 hours of the Holy Ghost moving him, talking to him, convincing him of his sin, convincing him of Jesus, he wrote the song Amazing Grace, one of the most popular songs in history, one of the most popular hymns. And we have it here. We are going to have Paul come, and he's going to minister Amazing Grace, the chains are gone. I would like you to stand while he's ministering this. And I would like you to receive grace, the grace that's here. I'd like for you to receive the grace that God has here for you. If you need anything from God, you can get it here because grace is working. Paul?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first say amazing grace.
Amen. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. Praise God.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures.
Join me.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace.
Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see.
Amen. Father, Jesus said, my house is called a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves, a house of merchandise. Well, this building, or this ministry in this building, was built on a man praying in tongues a lot, and that's me. I spent hours praying in tongues, praying in the Spirit the last few years. It's been very difficult to pray in tongues, to pray very hard because of the sins of God's people laid upon my spirit, upon my soul, on my faith. But I'm back, so we're going to pray in tongues a while. What do you say? Let's go. Boskionda, Boboski. O gosh, Gundai, Boshundabai, Bogadiobai, Boshgai, Bogibai, Bogobashi, Begadibai, Nikobashi, Begabai, Begad, Bogadibai, Boshgai, Bogadibai, Bogun, Boshgai, Boshiobai, Bogobai, Begad. They got it back. Moss, Dundar, Macadam, Mexique, Mexico, Mai, Mokka, Mai, Mokka, Mokki, Mangda, Macadamba, Mando, Kate, Mai, Mexique, Mai, Oppo, Gamba, Mangda, 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 May the man, the God, of the king, may the man, the God, of 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 the man, the God, the God, the God, the God, the man, the God, the man, the God, the man, the God, the man, the king, the man,
Thank you. Yeah.
Let go. 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 Come, stay, come, 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 stay, come, 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 stay, come, stay, 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 hey, right,
we invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.